My name is Morten Schenk. I come from a small consulting firm in Denmark. I do a lot of... Better?
Great.
I do a lot of blogging about exploitation, both user mode and kernel mode. You can read on the blog and also on GitHub. So this talk is primarily about how to leverage these vulnerabilities all from a low integrity standpoint inside a sandbox. So expect a lot of hex and C code here, and some ODAs. First, we'll go through some brief history on kernel exploitation, try and get everyone up to date, and then look at what kind of mitigations have been put in place in the latest versions of Windows 10, and see how we can actually overcome them. So, right about rare vulnerability. The best case of this vulnerability class is that you can write a control value at a control address somewhere in the kernel. But a more commonly found bug will most likely write a non-controlled or semi-control value at a control address in the kernel. So once that's possible, we have to leverage this write in some way to get kernel mode code execution. And the most important part about this is we have to know where to write. So that's one of the problems. These techniques shown here are for write what rare vulnerabilities, but they can be used for other vulnerabilities as well, like pool overflows or use after freeze. Yeah, so looking at Windows 7, it was actually quite easy back then. First of all, you could use just allocate code directly to the non-page pool because it was executable. Then use the built-in APIs of the operating system just to return the address of the allocation. And then use the write-what-rare to overwrite a function address, like in a health dispatch table, and then just call that and get your code executed in the kernel. Even easier, you can actually allocate user mode memory and execute that from the kernel as well. So this very easy back then. Going forward, Microsoft have to make quite a lot of improvements for security-wise. First of all, the APIs to get the kernel addresses have been blocked from a sandbox, so it's not possible to get these allocation addresses anymore. Furthermore, most built-in APIs use the non-page pool NX as a standard now, which means that the allocations are not allocated on executable pool memory. So even if we knew where they were, we couldn't execute code there. And finally, user mode, supervisory mode execution prevention, or SMEP, has been implemented as well, which means if we try to execute code in the user mode from the kernel, we'll get blocked as well. So the techniques of Windows 7 don't really work anymore. So what we need is we need a primitive, read-write primitive, just like we know from the browser exploits, just in the kernel. Some of the most known ones are the bitmap primitive and the window primitive. And these have existed for some years. The idea is for the bitmap primitive that you can get the address of a bitmap through a table called the GDI shared handler table. Once you have the location of a bitmap, you can use the vulnerability to overwrite the size of it. Once you've overwritten the size, you make sure you have two bitmaps after each other. Then use the first one to overwrite the second one and overwrite the pointer to the data area, and use the second one to read or write anywhere in memory. Similarly, we can use the window primitive. It's kind of the same thing. We leak the address of the window, this time using another table called the user handle table. Overwrite the size of what's called the extra bytes, and then use the set window long pointer parameter, the API, to allocate these change these extra bytes. And since we've overwritten the size of the extra bytes, we can actually change the pointer for the string name pointer of the window. And this allows us to read or write again anywhere in memory using user mode APIs. Regarding user mode kernel execution, user mode pages execution, we have to bypass SMEP or get the dep in the kernel disabled. The most commonly used method is overriding the page table entries using the write primitive. So we find the address of the page table entry for the code we want to execute, and simply either flip the NX bit or change a user mode page into a kernel mode page. And then we can execute it again. Sometimes a slight bypass in the kernel is needed as well for some exploits, especially when you want to run the shell code. There are two known techniques. First of all, the whole heap has been static in many, for many years. So there is a pointer there. So you know where there is a pointer to the NT kernel at a static address. Just like the SADT instruction can be used, you get an address back from the disruptor table, and then that there's an NT kernel pointer. Then you use a read primitive to read this pointer out and find the base address by simply going, taking the NT kernel pointer, going backwards in the driver and to find the PE header. This is kind of like where kernel mode exploitation was before the anniversary update last year. In the anniversary update, Microsoft did quite a few changes. We'll go through here, see how they try to mitigate our ways of doing kernel exploitation. First of all, they randomized the page table entries, which means we can't just flip the bit because we don't know where it is anymore. They removed all the kernel addresses of the bitmaps and other objects from the GDI shared user handle table, which means we don't know where to write anymore. So we can use a bitmap primitive. And also the SADT command has been mitigated. If we're running in, if using Hyper-V, then it simply gets not disclosed this value, so we don't know where the NT pointer is. So this breaks some of the stuff. Additionally, there are also some mitigations which run really public. What they did is that they made sure that the string name pointer of a window object has to point inside the desktop heap, because that's where the actual name gets allocated. So if we try to read right outside the desktop heap by overriding the pointer, we crash. So this also breaks the window primitive. So let's see if these mitigations actually work. Let's look at the bitmap first. So the bitmap is stored somewhere in memory. It's actually stored in what's called the large page pool. This takes place if the bitmap is at least 1,000 bytes long or more. Of course, the large page pool is randomized and reboot, so we don't know where it is beforehand. So we need some kind of kernel information leak to find it. Luckily, if we look at the TEP, we have the field Win32 thread info. It actually contains a pointer into the kernel. It doesn't point to the large page pool, but it does point close to it. So what we could do, we should try and stabilize the pool. First, allocate a few very large bitmap objects. Once this is done, we can add a static offset to the pointer we find, and we actually point inside our bitmaps. Sadly, we only point inside the data of the bitmaps. There's not really, we cannot really use that for a lot. But what we can do is if we delete the second of these bitmap objects and try and allocate around 10,000 new bitmap objects of a page each, we'll find that this point actually does point into the new bitmaps. So this is a way to find the bitmaps again. And since we know what the bitmaps are, yeah, we can just override the size and again use two consecutive bitmaps to actually get a primitive back. So even though Microsoft removed the addresses from the table, it's not really needed. And you can see here, I did a simulator write what where, just by overriding the length. And then going a few further in execution of the code, it's possible to read out the content of the kernel and also write to the kernel. So looking at the window primitive, well, we're not allowed to write outside the desktop heap. This is due to a new function called the desktop verify heap pointer. And every time we try to actually use the string name pointer by either reading or writing with it, well, we have to be, it's validated through this function. So it takes the base address of the desktop heap and the size of it and checks it inside these two. But what we notice is that the pointer comes from an object called a tech desktop object. And there's actually no validation performed in this object pointer. And the pointer is taken from our object, our window object, which means if we can find this pointer and replace it, we control the verification addresses. So what we do is we use the leak, which is known from the user handle table, and just leak the address of it. And then we just, when we overwrite the string name pointer, we also overwrite the pointer for the tech desktop object because it's the header as well. And then when we try to read it right, well, we control where the desktop heap is. So verification succeeds everywhere. Again, we can see here, I try and simulate a write what where. And just like before, we can read and write the argument to the kernel. So yeah, that's what was put in a version update. But this talk was about creators updates. Let's see what was done there, because they did additional mitigations. What we find, especially for the window object, is that the user handle table which we use to disclose addresses of the window objects has been changed. So before, we saw a lot of kernel addresses there, which were all the objects. They've been removed now. So we can don't know where the objects. We don't know where the windows are anymore. Additionally, the field called client delta, which is the offset from the user mode map desktop heap to the actual desktop heap, has been removed as well. So there's not really any way here of finding the window objects anymore. Additionally, we used the set window long pointer API to make sure we wrote the extra bytes to the kernel and overwrote the string name pointer. In the new update here, we see that when we perform this action, the content, which was kernel mode address we were interested in, is no longer written to kernel mode. It's written to user mode. So even if we actually knew where it was and we overwrote the length of it, when we try to actually override it, it doesn't work because we write to user mode instead. This, of course, breaks the primitive. It doesn't work anymore. Some different additional changes it did is that the size of the bitmap object header is increased. This doesn't break the primitive, but we need to make sure that we change the size so allocation alignment still works. And now the whole heap is also randomized. So we don't know where the NT pointer is anymore. So we actually did a lot of stuff to break the window primitive. Let's see if that actually works. As I said, the client delta is now gone, but if we inspect memory, we find that it's been replaced by a user mode pointer. And if we check what's there at the user mode pointer, we actually find the desktop heap. The kernel maps desktop heap to user mode to make lookups faster, but it also makes sure that we actually have the kernel addresses. The user handle table was nice because it was a metadata, so it was fast to do a lookup. But we don't have that anymore, but we have the actual data. So what we do instead is we just manually search for it. So we take the handle value, and we search through the desktop heap until we actually find it. Once we find it, we know where it's at. So we're still able to leak the address. But there was a different problem, right? Even though we knew the address, we overwrote the size of the extra bytes, we couldn't use it anymore because we're just writing to user mode memory. Looking at how that's working, we find that the size of extra bytes is actually defined when we register the window class. But when we register the window class, we set different parameters as well. We also set a parameter for an object called taxCLS, which also has extra bytes. And even better, it also has an API to set these extra bytes, and it's not the same. This one is called set class long pointer. And lo and behold, even though Microsoft tried to mitigate it, they only changed one of the APIs, didn't change the second one. So the extra bytes from a taxCLS object are still placed in the kernel, which means we can allocate a taxCLS object before the window object. We can use the extra bytes from the taxCLS object to write the string name pointer of the window object. And this way, we have a read-write primitive back again. It's not that easy to mitigate them. So this is clear. Even though in Creators Update, they did a lot of changes, we still have our primitives. But they did a lot of other stuff, right? To make sure that kernelizer is better, looking in memory, almost all the kernel memory is now randomized. The only place I know of that isn't is the user-shared data structure for the kernel. But it's not executable, and there's no pointers there. So it's not really that interesting. The whole heap and is randomized, SRDT is mitigated. So we need some new way to leak the NT kernel pointer. My idea is that perhaps you can find a leak that's primitive related. Would of course mean we need two bypasses since we have two primitives. And I want it to be the NT kernel pointer we leak. So to try and pursue this idea, I thought about ReactOS. ReactOS is a open source re-implementation of Windows XP, where they did reverse engineering of all the structures, which means that undocumented kernel structures are found there. Even though they're for Windows XP and 32-bit, they might give some hints. So looking at the data structure for the bitmap, or surface object as it's really called in the kernel, we find a field called HDev. And the explanation for that HDev is it's a pointer to another object called the dev object. Inspecting further, we find the React OS has documented this object as well. It actually contains a lot of function pointers, which means these function pointers point to some kind of kernel driver, which again gives us our kernel bypass, the SLI bypass. When we go and check our bitmap object, we find that the HDev field is empty. There's nothing there, which means we cannot find this. We cannot find the integral anyway. Luckily, the bitmap we created using Create Bitmap API isn't the only bitmap. There are several other APIs to create bitmaps with. One of them is the Create Compatible Bitmap. And trying to use this API shows that we actually do populate the HDev field now. And while this is popular, we can verify in the debugger that it does contain a pointer to a driver. It's not the NT kernel driver, but it's a driver. So how do we do this in the exploit? Well, what we do is we know where the first bitmap was at. We found that address. So we go to offset 3000. We free this bitmap. Then we reallocate it with the compatible bitmap. We just spray a couple hundred of these to make sure that one of them is reallocated in the same spot. Once that is done, we can just read out the pointer for the kernel driver. The reason I took this driver, sorry, this function, not any of the others, is that this function actually contains a call at offset 2b into the NT kernel. So from this, it's very easy just to read out NT kernel pointer, and then again use the read primitive to find the base address of the NT driver. So in this way, we have a generic bypass to find the NT kernel using the bitmap primitive. Looking at the window primitive, well, it's also documented on React OS. And the header structure for window object is kind of convoluted. It's a lot of structures nested in each other. But if we follow the chain, we find that a lot of the different header structures end up pointing at the Ethread of the current process. And the Ethread is very interesting because it contains a pointer to the NT kernel. So again, we just use our read primitive and the location of the window object to read out NT kernel pointer and then find the base address by looking for the PE header. So in this way, we actually have a way, generic way to find the NT kernel pointer, the NT base address, no matter which primitive we use. As I said, I would be dropping some extra stuff here. So actually, while I did this research, I found a couple of other bypasses. One of them is primitive independent, which comes from the tab. As I said, the Win32 thread info field, we use that to disclose the address of the bitmaps. But it's more than that, because it's actually the thread info pointer. And the thread info pointer points to the Ethread. As we saw before, the Ethread contains an NT pointer. So in this way, we can just read out an NT pointer without actually allocating any kind of objects, if we have a read primitive. So this would work with any other primitive as well, if someone found one. If we need to know where the bitmap primitives are, instead of using the tab, we can also use the desktop heap. It actually contains on Creator's update, we can find a pointer there, use the same static offset from it, and we get the address of the bitmaps again. This was luckily fixed on Creator's update after the submission of a talk, but it still works on the anniversary update. Using the thread local storage pointer, you can also disclose an address into the kernel, which could be used to find the address of the bitmaps. And finally, also mitigated on Creator's update, but still working on anniversary update, instead of allocating the window object and using the header of that, we can use the GSJET infrastructure directly by switching through that and actually finding the driver to the NT kernel by simply looking through structures until we land at the correct window object. So in this way, we're sure we have a way to bypass kernel SLR, even if one of them is fixed. Although it's always cool to bypass kernel SLR, what do we need it for? Well, we need to do something. And what we did before is we used the read-write primitive to override the page table entries. So the pages were either executable in the kernel, or we flipped a bit so it was a user mode page which turned into a kernel mode page. reason we could do that was before this, the page table entries were starting at a static base address. And we just calculate the address of the page table entries for any address. But now, since it's randomized, we cannot do that anymore. So we need to try to de-randomize it. And my thought is that even though it's randomized, the curl must use it a lot. So it must have APIs for this. And these APIs must work even if there's a randomization. So I looked up and I found a couple different APIs which are used. And the most simple one I found is called the mi-get-pte-address. And it's simply used to translate between an address and the PTE. And looking at it in IDA, doing a stat analysis, we find that on the left side, it still has a static address. So it's not compiled into it, it gets changed at runtime, because we can see on the right side that at runtime, the idea is different. But that also means that when the driver is running in memory, we have a way of actually finding the base address of the page table entries. So what we do is, we find this function, and from that we read the base randomized base address. And how do we find this function? Well, one way is, of course, since we have the base address of the kernel, the NC kernel, we just add a static offset. The problem with this is it doesn't work across patches, right? Every time there's a patch, the offset will change, and we need to fix it. So a better way would to do this dynamically. Since we have a read primitive, I would like to look this up. What we do is we just dump the content of the NC kernel, then search through it using a hashing function. As it turns out, a hashing function that just adds the first keywords of the function is collision-free. So we just calculate the hash beforehand, and then simply doing the execution of the exploit, use the read primitive to dump the content, and go through it until we find it. And doing this finds us across the different versions. From that, we could just read it out, since it's at offset 13, we read out the base address, and then we can use the old formula again with the updated address. And from this, we simply find it, page table entry. And we're back to where we were before. We can just allocate this case, our shellcode directly in kernel memory, flip the NX bit using page table entries and the write primitive, and then we can call the shellcode like before by overriding the health dispatch table and then invoking it. Similarly, we could also just allocate it in user memory and flip the bit so it becomes a kernel page instead, and execute it. Both will work. So this is like what we did before. So even though they've implicated a lot of changes, a lot of mitigations, well, we could bypass them all. And just to recap the steps here, we use the vulnerability to create a read-write primitive. From that, we leak the base address of the NC kernel using either of the primitives. We locate the address of this function. From that, we get the randomized base address of the PTE tables. We can calculate the PTE of our shellcode address, copy our shellcode to that page, then override the PTE of the shellcode, and run it. So yeah, this is just like we did before. There's not really any changes how to do kernel exploitation now. It's the same thing. But I thought, I like the old days of Windows 7 where we could allocate executable kernel mode memory and just execute it without flipping in kind of bits of the page table entries. Is that possible in Windows 10? That would be awesome. So I started looking into that. And the first thing you come across is how does the kernel actually allocate pool memory? Well, it uses an API called exAllocatePoolWithTag. And this API takes some arguments. One of them is the pool type. And even though the new standard is the non-page pool NX, the old one is still supported. It's also now called the non-page pool execute. So if we could invoke this API with the correct pool type, we'd allocate executable pool memory. And this API also returns the address of that pool memory. The only problem is, of course, that this API is a kernel mode API. We cannot call it directly for userland. So what we could do is we could, of course, overwrite the health dispatch table with this API, and we could call it. The problem is we need to control the arguments. And when we invoke the function through the health dispatch table, we can only specify two arguments, and they have to have specific values for it to actually work. So this system call doesn't work. We need a different one. Looking around, I found a very easy to pronounceable one, this NTGDI, DDDI, create allocation. And trying to follow that in the kernel, we find that it jumps through all the Win32K kernel drivers until it ends up being called through a function table. So it's a very thin trampoline, nothing gets touched on the way there. And looking at this function table, we find that this calls into a different driver. And best of all, that the arguments are not modified from the time of our system call in user land to the actual execution of the function through the function table. Additionally, the prototype of this function, the user mode function, is that it returns a keyword, which could be an address. So it fits all our requirements to actually call it, to call the allocate pool attack. The only thing missing is that we should be able to actually write that address there. And inspecting the function table, we find that it's writable. So we can just patch it using our write primitive and override it with the allocate pool attack API. But of course, we need to find it. Since it's a function table, it contains pointers we don't know beforehand, so we cannot use a hashing function to find it directly. So we need to find a function which uses this function table. And one function I found which works is the driver calculation state change notify. It's quite simple function, simple header, and calls into the function table. The only problem is it's located in the Win32K full.sys driver. We don't have the address of that. So we turn one problem into another. We need to find that kernel driver. One way to do that is using the PS loaded module list. It's a linked list which contains all the kernel drivers currently loaded. And looking through the structure, we find that the name of one driver is located at offset 60, and the base address of that driver is located at offset 30. So again, we could use our read primitive to read through this list, looking all the names until we actually find the correct driver name, and just read out the base address. So now we have the base address. But again, we turn the problem into a different one. Now we need to find the PS loaded module list. And this, since it's a this linked list, we can use a hashing function because we don't know the values of it. So again, we need to find a function which uses this. One function is the key capture persistent thread state, which is located in ntkernel. And we have the ntkernel base address, right? So now we can use a hashing function, find this function, from that get the base address, sorry, from that get the PS loaded module list, from that get the base address of the N32K full.sys, from that get the driver calculation state change notifier, and from that get the function table. Luckily, all of this takes less than a second when running, so it's not a problem. Once we got that, we simply override offset 68 with the allocate pool attack API, and then call it. Allocating pool memory, and returns our allocated pool memory. Then we use our write primitive to copy the shellcode into it and execute it by overwriting the function table with the allocated pool memory. This is like just like the days of Windows, almost like the days of Windows 7. Allocate, execute with pool memory, and execute it. This has a few more steps, so it's not more efficient in any way, but it's a different way. So if one method gets fixed, it doesn't work, we can use another one. So let's try and see it in action. So we have a Windows 10 here. I'm running in a low mandatory level, so just like inside a sandbox. So we try and run it, does the pool spray, and wants us to simulate the rightward where, so let's do that from the kernel debugger. We can see here that we get the address here, and it contains the length of the bitmap, just as we wanted. So just simulate the rightward where. So I increase the length here, let it execute. And we go back. We haven't had a crash, and we got a system shell. And as you can see, from the time I actually entered the simulated rightward where, so execution was less than a second. So even though all these lookups don't take any time in reality. So in summary, even though there have been a lot of mitigations in the current versions of Windows 7, the latest versions of Windows 7, none of the old techniques are really broken. We can revive them, we can bring them back. So rewrite primitives work, page table entry overrides work. We can actually leak the NTKernel in new ways, which didn't work before, but we could leak it. And we can actually also now allocate executable kernel pool memory. The code for this is already on GitHub. So you can get it there if you want to play with it. I want to say that, of course, I didn't find out all of this. There was previous research here, which I want to credit people for. Yeah. That's it. Thank you for listening to me.